and thanks to both of you. I've enjoyed having you be part of the flying circus as we have traversed the globe, and appreciate the attention that CNN pays to international news stories. It makes a big difference.
It's great to hear that.
Thanks for coming.
Well, in typical CNN style, let's begin with the news. Egypt.
Yes.
Turmoil.
Yes.
60 people approximately dead. The head of the army says that the state could actually fall apart, disintegrate. Is he right?
Well, I hope not, because I think that would lead to incredible chaos and violence on a scale that would be devastating for Egypt and the region. But there has to be some understanding by the new government that the aspirations that the people were expressing during the revolution in Egypt have to be taken seriously. And it cannot in any way be overlooked that there is a large number of Egyptians who are not satisfied with the direction of the economy and the political reform. This is not an easy task. I have to jump in and say that, you know, we can sit here and talk about it from a distance. It's very difficult going from a closed regime and a one-man rule to a democracy that is trying to be born and learn to walk. But there are some clear lessons. You have to represent all of the people, and the people have to believe that. You have to have the rule of law that applies to everyone, not just to some of the people. You have to have a constitution that respects and recognizes the rights of all people and doesn't in any way marginalize any group. So I think the messages and the actions coming from the leadership, you know, have to be changed in order to give people confidence that they're on the right path to the kind of future they seek.
Mm-hmm. Let's move to Benghazi. There have been a lot of questions. You've answered a lot of questions. But there's one in particular. You know, the signs were there. The British ambassador had been attacked. The walls of the embassy had been breached. Why didn't you connect the dots? Ask the question, wasn't it too dangerous for Chris Stevens, the ambassador, who was one of the most valuable people you had in that region? Why didn't you ask those questions?
Well, we were certainly aware of the increasing threat environment. I not only was briefed on that, I testified to that effect. And there were constant evaluations going on. But no one, not the ambassador, security professionals, the intelligence community, ever recommended closing that mission. And the reason they didn't was because the ongoing threat environment had, up until the spring before our terrible attack in Benghazi, been a result of post-conflict conditions. That is something that we're familiar with all over the world. Yes, there were some attacks, as you have said, but our evaluation of them and the recommendation by the security professionals was that those were all manageable, because we have a lot of that around the world. I mean, there is a long list of attacks that have been foiled, assassination plots that have been prevented. So this is not some, you know, one-off event. This is considered in an atmosphere of a lot of threats and dangers. And at the end of the day, you know, there was a decision made that this would be evaluated, but it would not be closed. And unfortunately, we know what happened.
Mm-hmm. Madam Secretary, I want to read you the headline of the article in the LA Times today. It said, Hillary Clinton's legacy at stake, splendid, but not spectacular. That you were hugely popular in this administration and around the world, but some of these big ticket items that we've been mentioning, particularly the Middle East, Iran, North Korea, not solved, still intractable, and maybe even worse in some instances. Is that how you see your legacy? Hugely popular, but didn't solve these horrible issues?
Well, I think that could be said about nearly every administration and certainly every Secretary of State, because when you come into office, you inherit the world that it is in reality, not the way you wish it would be. And I think we have to go back to my beginning in January of 2009 to remember how poorly perceived the United States was, how badly damaged our reputation was, how our leadership was in question, how the economic crisis had really shaken people's confidence in our government, our economic system, our country. Part of my job in the very beginning was to get around the world and restore confidence in American leadership, sometimes against some pretty tough odds because there were a lot of people pointing fingers at us, particularly over financial crisis. But it was important to stabilize the situation, which I think we did. I know the president was talking about that in an interview we did the other day, that, you know, let's be realistic here about what the conditions were. We had the war in Iraq that had to be wound down. We had a troop request for 30,000 troops sitting on the president's desk the first day he walked into office. We had so many serious problems. And I don't think anybody can argue with what we did to try to set the table. And then what did we do with that? You know, you can go down the list, and whether it's how we handled the Arab Spring and the work that had to be done in order to try to prevent even more serious challenges, how we put together an international coalition to inflict the toughest sanctions on Iran and North Korea. Not that those are solved, but, you know, diplomacy is sometimes, you know, building on steps one after the other, opening to Burma, pivoting to Asia, working to really strengthen our ties in Europe and Latin America and Africa. I'm very proud of what we've done. But equally so, we began to practice diplomacy in a different way. You know, not that we jettisoned everything that had been done before, but we added new tools in the toolbox. We also expanded the aperture.
You broke a lot of glass ceilings. You brought women a lot in leadership to the State Department. You've said this is your life cause to end the double standard. You're leaving office. Four top positions in this administration in the cabinet, none of them are women. Is that a problem?
Well, I think you have to wait to see the entire makeup of the cabinet.
Top four positions, though, the top four secretaries that are considered crucial to this administration, particularly in national security.
Well, you know, I'm not going to pass any judgments. I think that what we have to do is take a look at the broad picture. But clearly, from my perspective, we have to keep providing opportunities for young women to get into that pipeline so that they are ready.
There are no women out there for these top positions?
Oh, no. Obviously, I think there are. But I think that there is still a ways to go until we have the kind of critical mass that I want to see. And, you know, we've made progress in the number of women in the Senate, but it is still abysmally small. You know, there are so many, on the one hand this, on the other hand that. We make progress. There's no denying that. But we haven't firmly institutionalized that progress. And as much as we have done here, I look around the world, and my goodness, there's so much to be done.
Well, there are a lot of women leaders around the world. In April, you told Wolf Blitzer for 2016, that's not in my future. But you seem to be, leaving some wiggle room there. Have you decided?
No. I am so looking forward to Monday when I have no schedule, no office to go to,
you know,
no responsibilities.
I'm sorry, Madam Secretary. You know, the party says that the field is clear and open for you until you make your decision. Have you decided that you absolutely will not run?
Well, I have absolutely no plans to run.
But look at, you're not saying this is not a Sherman-esque statement. I will not run. We heard this morning all of these people asking you if you can run. There's a PAC just registered, ready for Hillary.
Is there really?
Are you going to tell these people to stand down? Everyone is waiting
well,
for that.
You know, right now, I am trying to finish my term as Secretary of State. And the president and I had a good laugh the other night because, you know, I am out of politics right now. And I don't know everything I'll be doing. I'll be working on behalf of, you know, women and girls. I'll be hopefully writing and speaking. Those are the things that I'm planning to do right now.
Let's talk about it. You said that Monday morning, we presume next week.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
You wake up, maybe you stay in your pajamas. What do you do?
Jill, I don't know. It's been my whole life. I mean, I've had a job ever since I was 13 years old. Even when I wasn't in school, I was working. So.
But is it going to be traumatic? I mean, your BlackBerry?
I don't know. I think it's going to take some adjustment. You know, I've been talking to colleagues who left the government earlier, and the most common thing they say to me is, don't make any decisions. You have no idea how tired you are. And I think there's truth to that. I mean, Your viewers know, because they're interested in these issues, this is a 24/7 job because there's no part of the world we can ignore. Maybe 4 years, 8 years, 12 years, certainly 20, 30, 40 years, there were big chunks of the world that were not of direct interest to our security or other matters that we were concerned about.
But how did you get the energy? I mean, are you going to be able to stop? Are you going to be able to stop?
Well, you know, you'll have to talk to me in a few weeks to see how I'm doing. I think that I'm really looking forward to it. I know it sounds, you know, vague because I have never done this before in my life. So when I wake up Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, to have the luxury of nowhere to go, nothing to do, no frantic call about calling some leader about some impending crisis, I'm actually interested to see how that goes.
Now, what about your health? Because I do have to ask you this. We talked with a couple of doctors, mm-hmm. and they say that if you have had one blood clot, mm-hmm. there is a 2x chance that you will have another one. I mean, is this something that you're going to have to deal with for a long time?
Well, millions of people do. I mean, it's very common.
Will you take medication?
Well, that's what people do when they have blood clots, and then you get evaluated after the blood clot has resolved because, as you say, I've experienced this before. But I am lucky because I've been very healthy. I feel great. I've got, you know, enormous amounts of energy that have to be harnessed and focused. So I'm very fortunate, and I'm looking forward to this next chapter in my life, whatever it is.
Before you leave, be
subtle but persistent about it.
Before you leave, normally a secretary leaves a gift for the next secretary mm-hmm. coming in. Mm-hmm. Can you tell everybody in the world what you're going
to do? No, I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to let that be between John and me. You know, John and I have been friends and colleagues for a very long time. And he's extremely well prepared, as you know, for this job. And I think he doesn't need very much gifting, but, you know, I've got something that might help.
Just one last question about the family you've got. President Clinton, international health. You have Chelsea, who studied international health.
Right.
You're interested in women, development, mm-hmm. health issues. Mm-hmm. So what do you do? Are you all, is there a chance that you would all work together?
Like I hope so. I mean, that's one of the things we have to really work out is I'm very proud of what my husband has done in the last 10 years. I mean, his foundation, his entrepreneurial philanthropy with the Clinton Global Initiative, his great work on getting the price of AIDS drugs down so that more people could get treatment and so much else. And he is also focused on the health of children here in this country through the Healthy Alliance. So he's doing things that resonate with me as well as with him. And we're going to look to see how we can join our efforts together.
What about Chelsea?
She's great.
She says she wants to lead a life of public service.
Yes.
Makes you proud. Is she going to run?
No, I don't know.
Family
about
business?
I think she is really focused on the philanthropy. You know, she did a great, great service after Hurricane Sandy. She took a large group, about 1,000 people that were put together through our foundation and through CGI to go and do a lot of difficult manual work for people who had been just devastated. You know, she and Bill and I, we just have public service in our DNA. That doesn't have to be political service. It can be what we're doing now and what Bill has been doing now. So I think we'll work all that out. It's going to be fun to talk it through and figure out, you know, what our next adventures might be.
Well, Madam Secretary, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I wish you
Secretary.
A lot of health.
Thank you.
And a lot of adventures.
I think we'll have some adventures, and maybe the two of you can come along again
sometime.
We'd love that.
We'd love
it. It's a deal.
Thank you.
Thank you.